Good morning. Today we want to discuss the bootstrap, which is a very generic and general and also powerful method in statistics, in particular in non-parametric statistics. So consider you're in a situation where you have to make an estimate of a complicated quantity and you don't have any distribution assumptions. So consider a medical quantity or something like estimating the correlation between school grades and family income. It would be really difficult to have distribution assumptions for these kind of estimates, or if you want to run a test on such data. However, Bootstrap provides a method by which we can still use for statistics even if we don't know any or if we don't have any distribution assumptions. We have already in one of the last lectures seen a couple of different methods for non-parametric statistics, and maybe the one that is closest to the bootstrap is permutation tests. Because in permutation tests, what you do is you're given the sample of your data, and then you randomly scramble your data in the permutation test. You scramble the label of your data, the class membership. So you resample your data by doing something slightly different and then use the resampled data to estimate, for example, what might be a confidence interval or what might be the standard deviation of an estimate. Now the bootstrap is a more generic method of achieving something similar. And before I want to outline how it really works, let me maybe again come up with a bit of motivation. So assume we have a sample, so motivation. Assume we have a sample x1, xn, that comes from some distribution f, but we do not have any assumptions on the underlying distribution, typically. I write no assumptions on f, or no knowledge on f, I mean beyond the sample, of course, that we observe. And we want to estimate a parameter, some kind of statistics, the average correlation, or if you want the mean, that would be sort of the simplest case. Just one number that sort of describes your sample in an interesting way. So, the parameter theta is some function of the underlying distribution, and of course, because you don't know the underlying distribution, you have to estimate this parameter theta. So what you get is, you generate an estimate, theta hat, based on the sample. And now, in statistics, there are a different number of things you want to do, but the first thing is, essentially you want to get a feeling for how reliable is this estimate. And what is reliability in terms of statistics? The first thing you might want to look at is the standard deviation or the variance of your estimate, because you want to know if I would repeat this whole process and draw a new sample and I would compute yet another estimate of this parameter theta, would it sort of be close to the one I already have, or is the variance of this estimate so large that essentially I can't really rely on the fact that this estimate has a certain value. Okay, we want to know how reliable theta hat is. And one thing, as I said, the first thing you might want to look at is the standard error. So the first thing to look at is the standard error. SE. So if you remember, the standard error is the standard deviation of this estimate. Of course, there are other things that might be interesting as well. So if you know that the standard error is small, so your estimate is very concentrated, for example, so if you repeat the experiment, you essentially get the same kind of estimate. Then there are other quantities that are also important. For example, is there a bias, or maybe we want to test something, but let's for now concentrate on the standard error. Now, what are the options we have? So the first option is, if we have distribution assumptions, if we have assumptions on F. If we are really lucky, we know what the underlying distribution is. We can analytically compute the distribution of theta hat, the standard error, or at least an estimate, and so on. But this is rare. So this case where we can compute everything in practice, I mean, if you want to estimate means or so, that might work, but beyond that, it is often not the case. So what is the other option you would have? Another very principled approach would be, you say, well, I have now drawn a sample of 100 points, maybe I can draw another sample of 100 points, and I can repeat this process and get at least an empirical estimate of how the distribution of these estimates might look like. So maybe, sorry to conclude this, so what I would get here in this first approach is maybe I have my theta hat here, and I get an estimate for how the distribution of theta hat might look like. Now the other approach I've been mentioning is you could draw many samples, repeat the experiment, and get an empirical distribution. We could also try to obtain many samples. So we do it x1 to xn, and then we do it a second time. We have another population, x1, 2, xn, maybe I should write it in parentheses, x11, x12, x1 to xn, m. So I repeat this process very often. So this is supposed to be a 1 here. And then I can get a consistent estimate based on all these samples. So many samples, and then estimate the distribution of theta hat. And if you do that, it might then look like, the plot is a bit similar to what we had before, but now it's maybe histograms, something like that. And here is maybe the theta hat we had first. And if you repeat the experiment, you sort of chop your space into different bins, you count how often does my estimate end up in this particular bin, and you generate a histogram. And if everything works well, typically the red histogram should converge to the red function, so the red histogram that we would generate by doing the experiment over and over again would eventually converge to this underlying distribution if things don't go completely wrong. Okay, so these are two obvious things that we might want to do, but we cannot do both of these things. The first one, because we don't know the distribution. The second one, because we simply don't have, typically, we don't have so many samples. So the problem here, problem, need too many samples. And now, finally comes the idea of the bootstrap. Idea of the bootstrap. The idea of the bootstrap is now that we mimic this approach where we sample over and over again. So ideally we would like to draw many, many independent samples, each of size n. Now we cannot do that, we just have one sample. But what we can do is we can subsample from this sample we already have. So the idea is we're given the sample x1 to xn, and now we draw a subsample of x1 to xn. And on the first sample we estimate theta hat. Maybe I call it theta original. So this is the original estimate. And now I draw a subsample. And then I simply estimate the quantity I'm interested in just on my subsample. And then I repeat this process very often. I draw lots of subsamples, and each And on each subsample, I compute the statistic I want to estimate, and of course, there's also going to be a variance. Draw a subsample of n, compute a statistic theta star if you want. And this we repeat very often. Repeat very often. And then we also get a histogram. So this is now a histogram based on resampled data. And resampling here really means it's not I draw a new independent sample, but I draw a subsample of my independent, of the sample I already have. And the idea is, like, when I draw a sub, like, I first draw a subsample, I draw my first sample, IID, from the underlying distribution. If I now draw a subsample, this is also a sample that can be considered coming from the original distribution. So if I estimate the quantity, theta hat in this particular case, then this estimate follows the same distribution, or hopefully follows the same distribution as the one I had originally. So if I'm careful, maybe this approach is going to work. And then the idea would be that the red histogram that we have here is hopefully close to the red histogram we have here. So maybe I should write this. The hope is hope histogram of these theta stars. So this is here the histogram of theta star is close to the histogram of theta hat. I don't really have a good, maybe I should give it a some number. So this is number one, this is number two, sorry, let's make it this way, this is number three. So the histogram of theta star is close to the histogram of theta, which is hopefully close to the first histogram, to the first underlying distribution. Okay. This is the overall idea. And now I want to spell it out a bit more in detail how this really works. So I write an algorithm in pseudocode how this works. So the input, input to our algorithm is the original sample we have, x1 to xn. And of course we also know which is the statistic we want to compute. I don't want to write this down now, that's somehow clear. And now we do a for loop, b equals 1 to some capital B. So this for loop is going to contain all the repetitions of this resampling we are going to do. So b for bootstrap, and a capital B is the number of bootstrap replications. Number of bootstrap replications. Okay, now what do we do inside the loop? We now draw a subsample of x of the original sample. And how do we do this? We sample x1, and it's now denoted with a star, xn star, uniformly with replacement from the original sample x1 to xn. Now here is something really important. So n, maybe I write this here, is the number of original sample points. And what is really crucial here is now that the number of points we subsample from the original sample is also n. Now if you would subsample without replacement, then this would be pointless, because if I have n points and I subsample n other points without replacement, I get exactly the same sample back. So what we do here is we sample with replacement. So it might be that, or it is typically the case that we sample some points a couple of times, but some other points we don't see at all. The key idea here is that what we want to achieve is that the size of the sample in this bootstrap sample is the same as the original sample size. Because many statistics depend on the sample size. So if we estimate a quantity on a smaller sample size, then we might simply get a different behavior. So what we want to achieve here is that the sample on which we try to estimate the distribution of our original estimate has the same size as the subsample distributions. Okay, so we sample all these guys, and now we estimate for each of these subsamples we draw, we estimate the parameter. Estimate the parameter theta who hat star, and now I give it an index b, which is the index of the sub sample I've just drawn. Okay, and this I repeat capital B times, and now I have I have now capital B replications, and in each of these replications I estimated this parameter theta hat star. And now I've seen many of these theta hat stars. Now I can look at what is the standard deviation of these estimates. For example, now estimate the standard error, SE hat, of the original estimate, theta hat. Now, by the standard deviation of these bootstrap samples, right? By the standard deviation of the bootstrap replicates. So what I do here is, so I'm interested in the standard error based on B bootstrap samples, if you want, bootstrap replicates. And this is now just 1 over b minus 1. We use in this case the unbiased estimate, but that's not so important. Sum over b equals 1 to capital B. And now maybe I first write it down. Theta hat star b minus, 1 over b sum I equals 1, 1 to b. Theta star I. Now I need to make sure I don't make a mistake here. Square to the power 1/2. So this looks complicated, but it's simple. So what is this here? This is the mean. So this is just the formula for an estimated variance. So this is the mean of the bootstrap. If you want, this is C. This kind of is hard to read. I write it in words. This is the mean of the replicates, and then the rest is the estimate for the standard deviation, right? So for each point, we check how far is it from the standard deviation in square norm. We sum all these terms. We normalize by 1 minus b minus 1, and then we need to take the square root because we don't look at the variance but at the standard deviation. And this is now the bootstrap procedure for estimating the standard error. I should have written this before. Example, estimate the standard error of an estimate theta hat. Okay, so let us maybe look at it once more. So we have this original sample. Based on this original sample, we can already estimate this quantity theta hat. Now we want to know how reliable is it. So now we resample from the original sample. We generate a new sample with replacement. We estimate the quantity. So what we get out of this for loop, maybe I make it like this. So this gives us these capital B estimates, so we get theta hat star 1 to theta hat star capital B. So these capital B estimates, and these are now the ones that go into into this estimate of the standard error, where we now say we look at the standard error of all these capital B estimates, and this is the estimate of the standard error in this sample is what is the standard deviation of this sample of estimates here is the standard error of the original thing that we've been looking at. Okay. So this is a very straightforward procedure. Of course, it might be computationally expensive because we have to have these B replicates here. And depending on how complicated it is to estimate this parameter, this could, of course, take some time. But in most cases, this is like we now have the computational power to do these kind of things. So it is very unlikely that you wouldn't have enough power to run such an experiment. Now the question is, of course, does it really work? I mean, this sounds like a great idea, and maybe for some historical perspective, this has been suggested by Efron, I believe, in 1979 or 1980. Well, around the 1980s, I don't know when it exactly was published, this method came out. It's one of the first resampling method that, or a very generic resampling method, and it became very popular ever since then. But now the question is really, is it just a heuristic or does it work? And so the question is, what kind of theoretical guarantees can we give for this procedure? So does it always work? So what do I mean by does it work? So now maybe I should be a bit more precise. Now what we have is we have here a quantity, an estimated quantity, which the way I've written it down is supposed to be an estimate of the standard error. And the question is, under which conditions would this estimate of the standard error really converge against the true standard error? In probability, or almost surely, that's maybe not even so important. So what are probably, and if you try to think about this, what are probably the things that you need? And if you want to have an estimate and it's supposed to converge to the true underlying thing, first of all, the sample size needs to go to infinity. So probably what we need is that n, the sample size of the original sample, needs to go to infinity. Because otherwise, I mean, if we just do this on a finite sample, even if we do infinitely many bootstrap replicates, we don't know the full story. So n definitely needs to go to infinity. And then, of course, this number of bootstrap replicates probably also needs to go to infinity, because even if I have infinitely many sample points, if I now just draw 10 bootstrap replicates, of course it's not, I mean, convergence cannot yet take place, because it's again a finite quantity. So probably what you need is that n goes to infinity and b goes to infinity. Okay. And I don't even want to spend so much time in actually proving such a theorem or writing it down very carefully. I just want to give you the gist. So the gist is, let me first write down the theorem and then we see what happens. Theorem. And the theorem is about the consistency of the estimate of the standard error. So this is the procedure we just had. We estimate the standard error. Now we want to say, when is it consistent? Okay, and now what are our assumptions? So we assume that our original sample has been generated IID. So we have x1 to xn, which has been drawn from f, IID. Okay, so currently we always work on the assumption that the sample is independent, otherwise it gets very complicated. And we also assume that the expectation of x1 square, so essentially the second moment, the variance of this random variable, is finite. I mean, if the variance of this guy is not finite, then statistics gets difficult anyways. For example, if the variance of the original thing is not finite, even the central limit theorem or the law of large numbers might not hold, so then it's hardly conceivable that that the bootstrap always is going to work, in particular because the quantity we're going to estimate is something related to the variance of the original sample. So this makes a lot of sense to have the assumption that the second moment or the variance of this original sample is finite. Okay, so this is the first assumption on the underlying distribution, and now we need to have a second, probably we also need to make some assumptions on what is the quantity we want to estimate. And if it's a nice quantity like the mean, it is going to work, but maybe there are cases where the quantity we want to estimate is something so awkward that the bootstrap estimate might not work. And indeed, now we need to have regularity assumptions on the estimate we want to make. Now let me write this down. Let theta hat n, this is a function of the original sample. So g is the function that computes this estimate of the parameter that we're interested in. Let this be the parameter that we estimate. And now we need to make assumptions on this function g. Assume that g is continuously differentiable, in a neighborhood of the mean. Of mu, which is the expectation of x1, with a non-zero gradient. So essentially, what we're going to do is we're going to average over many quantities, and so what we need to have is that this function g behaves reasonably well, at least in a neighborhood of the of the mean of our random variable. And then, if these two quantities, these two conditions, so we had the conditions on the underlying distribution and the conditions on the thing we want to estimate, and now the statement is then the bootstrap estimate of the standard error is strongly consistent. Strongly consistent, if you remember, means it converges almost truly. Now, I don't want to be more specific here, so you have to have n go to infinity, b to infinity. I don't want to go into too much detail here. If you're interested in that, in fact, it is not so nicely spelled out, or not precisely in the books that we take as the basis of our lecture, but there is a book by Shao and Tu, I believe, that it's also called something like the bootstrap or so, and it gives more theoretical results about bootstrap, in particular lots of consistency results, and I took the theorem from that book. Okay, so this is now a theorem that states under reasonable conditions, the bootstrap estimate is going to work. Now, of course, the obvious question is, does it always work? And the answer is no. So I want to give you an example where the bootstrap estimate does not work. Example where it goes wrong. And this is an example you find in many different textbooks, and I'm going to outline it first. So assume that x1 to xn, our original sample, has been generated from the following distribution, from the uniform distribution on the set 0, theta. So theta is a parameter, say between 0 and 1, where theta is somewhere in 0, 1. Okay, and theta is unknown. So we have a uniform distribution, but we don't know what the theta is, like the interval on which the uniform distribution is defined. And this is the parameter we want to estimate. We want to estimate theta. Now this, spontaneously, this reminds me of a different problem in statistics that you see, that's an example for lots of interesting questions. So assume you have taxis going around in New York, and assume the taxis have a number on their roof. So I don't know, each taxi has a certain number, and like if there would be a helicopter over New York, it could observe the taxis and see there's taxi 250 and here's taxi 700, 200, 725 or so. And now the question is, if you assume these taxis have been numbered consecutively and you observe all the numbers of the cabs running around, can you estimate what is the number of cabs in New York? And of course, like if you like under this naive assumption that all the numbers have been given to a cab consecutively, so if you observe cab number 250, you of course know that there are at least 250 cabs in New York. So a good estimate to, or a first estimate that you could come up with, if you want to estimate the number of cabs, is you observe all the cabs you see. That's a subsample of your whole population. And then the highest number that you observe is the number that you could take as an estimate of the number of cabs in New York. Of course, it might be, it's plausible that this estimate is a bit too conservative, because if the taxi with the highest number on its roof doesn't run around, you wouldn't see it. So you can only, so you can only underestimate the true number of taxis. You can never overestimate it, at least under these naive assumptions. Now this is a similar problem here. So we have data coming from the uniform interval between 0 and theta. So theta is what is the number of taxis is in New York. And we want to estimate the parameter theta. So what is the size of our support here? Now what you can prove easily is that if you look at the maximum likelihood estimate in this particular problem, the maximum likelihood estimate is indeed to look to take the largest number, the largest observation, and take this as your estimate. So the maximum likelihood estimate of theta is simply the largest number we observe. So this is the estimate theta hat is the maximum I equals 1 to n of all the xi. Okay. Now, if you want to get the reliability of this estimate by bootstrap, it is not going to work. Estimating the standard error by bootstrap is going to fail. And if you don't believe that, I mean, one can of course not prove it theoretically, which is maybe takes a bit of work. If you wanted, you could simply simulate this. This is a matter of half an hour to implement this kind of problem. To bootstrap replicates, look at the standard error of your estimate and compare it, and you will see that this is not going to work. And the reason is, what is difficult here is we are trying to estimate an extreme parameter. So estimating something that is the mean of a distribution or so, this always works very nicely. So if you want to estimate the mean, it's in the sort of in the center of your distribution, everything is nice, the central limit theorem occurs and so on. If you want to estimate properties of the tail of your distribution, so the tail of a distribution, if you have a distribution like this, the tail is what happens out here, so very far away from where most of the events happen, this is something that is typically much more difficult. It's sometimes also called extreme value statistics if you want to estimate extreme values. Things are much more complicated here because, in particular, if the tails of a distribution do not behave like a normal distribution or so, but have a considerable amount of weight. And this is also what is going to happen here. So estimating tails or extreme values by bootstrap is difficult or is problematic. Okay, so this is simply an example where it goes wrong. Okay. Now we've seen one example how you can use the bootstrap to estimate a parameter and in particular the standard error of your parameter. Of course, this works for many different parameters. You can always apply this. But sometimes you also want to do more. You, for example, want to construct confidence sets for an estimate. And this is the next thing we want to look at. Confidence sets by Bootstrap. And now the idea, and this is sort of the whole idea of Bootstrap, is very simple. So the naive idea of Bootstrap is we generate many resamples, so we resample our data very often. We look at the empirical distribution, and this empirical distribution tells us everything we want to know. There are several approaches that I'm going to mention here, but the typical approach is what is called the Bootstrap percentile method. And this is sort of the one that comes directly from the original Bootstrap idea. You're given a sample, given the sample x1 to xn. So generate Bootstrap, from the original sample we estimate theta hat, and now we generate Bootstrap replicates and obtain theta 1 hat star up to theta b hat star. And now we consider simply the look at the histogram. So the histogram simply looks like this. It might look like this. So this is the histogram of all these estimates, theta b star. And now, what do we want? We want to find a set such that with 95, if you want to construct a confidence set, such that under the true distribution, the likelihood that we end up in the set is at least 95%. So what we now do is we look for the quantiles. So here we have the quantile of alpha over 2. So what is the quantile again? Maybe I plot the cumulative distribution function below. So this is the histogram. And here I plot the CDF, the empirical CDF of these Bootstrap replicates. And this is, of course, a step function. And maybe I should try to make it somehow similar to what I've drawn on top. So my pen was about to give up. So this is maybe how the CDF looks like. It is, of course, an increasing function. That's always the CDF is an increasing function. It increases a bit steeper in the beginning. Maybe I should have at least a bit of mass here as well. So it increases and then increases quite steeply where we have these big bars here. So here we have the big bars, so the CDF increases steeply and then increases only slowly because of this tail of the histogram. The quantile, if you remember, is sort of the place where the CDF has the value alpha over 2 or 1 minus alpha over 2. So here we have the value alpha over 2, and at this other end here we have the value 1 minus alpha 2, and this is here the same, 1 minus alpha over 2. That's hard to read. 1 minus alpha over 2. Okay, so we look at these quantiles and then we simply take the thing that is in between as our confidence set. What we do is we define the confidence set, which is just I need to give name to these quantiles. Maybe I call this A and this B. So the confidence set we construct is then AB. Okay, and observe that this is I mean the intuition why this might be correct. Again, consider what is a confidence interval. It needs to satisfy that under the true parameter. So if we assume that theta is a true parameter, then this estimate of theta should end up in this confidence interval in alpha, 1 minus alpha of all the cases, 95% of all the cases, for example. Now, this resampling that we always do, so our original sample comes, of course, from the distribution with parameter theta. Now, if you resample, these resampled points also come from the distribution with parameter theta. So what we generate is an empirical distribution of where this estimate theta hat might sit. Hopefully it's an unbiased estimate, like this histogram is hopefully unbiased. And then the confidence set is going to work in the sense that in 95% of the cases, the estimated parameter sits in this confidence set. Okay, so what we have, so it has coverage 1 minus alpha, because we have that maybe I write it first, theta hat in CI is larger or equal to 1 minus alpha. So the quantity we need to prove is that if theta is the true parameter, and we compute theta hat, then it is supposed to end up in our confidence set in at least 1 minus alpha of all the cases. And this is exactly what we do here. If we can assume at least that this histogram that we generate here is true or unbiased or consistent estimate of the underlying true distribution. So, and this coverage here, of course, on a finite sample, there might be slight deviation still, but in the limit, at least the coverage should be correct. Maybe I should write approximate coverage. It has coverage, I write here maybe approximately. Where this approximately refers to the fact that we still have a finite n. N and b are finite. And I don't want to give you the proof why this works, but under similar kind of conditions as the ones we've seen before, you can prove that this confidence set is consistent in the sense that this approximately coverage property in the limit for n to infinity and b to infinity works out. Okay, and now this, observe, this is like sort of, in my feeling, this is sort of the main thing you need to remember about the bootstrap philosophy. So the philosophy is we resample the thing we are interested in many, many times, very often. We generate this histogram of the empirical estimates that we observe, and then you can do all kinds of things. Once you have the confidence sets, of course, you can also construct tests. Because if you want to construct tests, you now need to simply know that you want to test whether the quantity you estimate is smaller or larger than a threshold or equals a certain parameter, and all you need to do now is you now need to check whether the thing that you're interested in is in this confidence set here or not. So maybe I just write this. Subsequently, you can construct bootstrap tests. I just write in the obvious way. And maybe I just repeat it once more. So what is the obvious way? I have this parameter theta, and I generate all these bootstrap replicates. So this is the distribution of theta hat star, the histogram. Now maybe say I want to test H0, theta hat is 0 versus H1, theta hat is not 0. And now here I have maybe 0 here. And now here I also need to have now a confidence. I need to plot the confidence set. So maybe my confidence set is here. So these are the quantiles. So this is the quantile. The first one is the alpha over 2 quantile. The last one is the 1 minus alpha over 2. So this is what I denoted A and B earlier, the two ends of the confidence set. And now In this particular example, zero is far outside the confidence set. So the probability that if zero would be the true parameter, it would end up in here is, so this is very low. So we would refute the hypothesis. In this particular example, we would refute the hypothesis that theta hat is zero. Okay, and in this way, you can now mimic all of statistics in terms of these bootstrap replicates. And whenever in statistics you need to have to know the underlying distribution, you replace it by this histogram that you generate from the observed bootstrap replicates. So this is what I wanted to say about bootstrap. Of course, I've just scratched the surface here, so there is lots to know about bootstrap. You can use bootstrap for many, many different things. There's also many more improvements, so many people in the bootstrap community would consider this this procedure here I use to construct this confidence interval as too simplistic. So there are lots of more complicated ways of doing these things. But what I want you to know and to remember is this very general principle of bootstrap. You take the original sample, you resample with replacement, and then you look at the histogram and do things. Maybe as a last remark, the bootstrap is also related to many other methods. So something else you might often hear about is the jackknife. That was in a historical sense, it was earlier than the bootstrap. The jackknife is essentially what we do in machine learning in cross-validation. The jackknife means I just take a subsample, a smaller subsample of my original data set and try to estimate the quantity there. And maybe in a similar way as cross-validation works in machine learning. What else? There's also a bagging. That's yet another term related to the bootstrap literature, which is called, so bagging is an abbreviation for bootstrap aggregation, so bag. Bootstrap aggregation. This is essentially something that happens, for example, in random forests in machine learning, where you you have your original sample, you build a random forest on a certain subsample of, for example, you either subsample data points or your subsample dimensions, build a decision tree, which is one classifier, and then you do the procedure again. You take a different subsample of your data, you subsample a different set of dimensions, build yet another decision tree, and in this way you generate many decision trees, and in the end you say they're supposed to do a majority vote or so. And such a method is of course very much related to bootstrap, because we do this resampling procedure over and over again, and this happens all over the place in machine learning. And I think the important philosophy is keep in mind that by resampling your data, you might get out more information than by simply estimating a single quantity. And if you want, this is also maybe a good way to introduce the next kind of topic that we're going to talk about, the Bayesian approach, where namely we also try to get more information than just a single estimate. We look at distributions of quantities. So the bootstrap also looks at distributions of quantities, and these distributions can be generated from our original sample. There is no magic behind it. It's not like we can generate out of the thin air, we can generate new knowledge that is not in our original sample. But maybe the philosophy of very traditional statistics, that you're given one sample and we simply reduce the sample to one number, say the mean, that is maybe a very strong reduction of all the information that you have in your sample. And the bootstrap essentially tries to bring out more of the information that is hidden in your sample. Namely, we can estimate this quantity, but maybe also its standard error. So in this sense, it is a very generic method. And whenever you have to do statistics and you don't know what is the underlying distribution, you might want to consider bootstrap. And then you might maybe run a couple of simulations whether you believe that in your particular scenario, the bootstrap is really going to work and is consistent. Because as we've seen, it is consistent in most of the cases, but not in all of them. And to be sure, if you want, you can also try to open a book and of course try to prove or look at the conditions under which bootstrap is consistent. In many, many applications it is, but often one, but there are also applications where you have to be careful. For example, I've worked on a project where we wanted to look at bootstrap confidence sets for estimating ratios of random variables. So you have two random variables, X and Y, both are random. and now you want to estimate a confidence set. And now the problem is, what happens if the denominator gets too close to zero? The statistic gets very complicated. So in these kind of cases, you need to be careful. If your statistics is something about the average behavior of a sample, and unless your distribution is, the original sample distribution is really heavy-tailed, then typically Bootstrap is going to work.